Welcome to the today's session on case study deep groove wall bearing selection from manufacturer's catalogue. Myself Prashant Pushare welcomes you for today's session on selection of bearing from manufacturer's catalogue. Today's session we are going to see how to select a deep groove wall bearing from manufacturer's catalogue based on its application. The learning objective of today's session is select deep groove wall bearing from manufacturer's catalog. After this session, you will able to select deep groove wall bearing from manufacturer's catalog. For case study, I have selected one problem of a shaft on which pulleys and gear which is mounted on it. And how to select a bearings for a transmission shaft, that we are going to see in this session. The problem statement that I am going to read here: a transmission shaft rotating at 720 rpm and it is going to transmit power from the pulley P to the spur gear G, which is shown in figure. The belt tensions are also given and the gear tooth forces are also given. The gear tension, that is T P1 498 Newton, that is tight side tension, P2 slack side tension 166 Newton, then tangential force on this gear, that is 497 Newton, radial force 181 Newton. Again, here in problem statement, weight of the pulley is given 100 Newton and the diameter of the shafts at bearing position B1 is 10 mm and bearing position B2 is 20 mm. Is also given. The load factor is 2.5 and the expected life for 90% of the bearing is 8000 hours. And what we have to do, we have to select a row, single row deep groove ball bearings at bearing position B1 and B2. For this purpose, here in problem statement, for the same figure is also given. Referring to this figure, look at this here. The B1 is the bearing 1, B2 is the bearing 2. Then in between bearing 1 and bearing 2, gear is mounted. This gear is a spur gear, which is subjected to two forces. You know the spur gear, teeth are cut straight or you can say parallel to the axis, subjected to two forces. Radial load as well as the tangential force position is also shown in figure. Then again here at the right hand side here, pulley P which is mounted. And here it rotates in anti-clockwise direction, arrow is also shown. And again here in the animated video, you will find this pulley is also going to rotate in anti-clockwise direction. Then this is bearing B1, this is bearing B2, it's a roller contact bearing, or you can say the ball bearing. This is a spur gear. Again here the tight side tension is given P1, slack side tension is shown P2, and distance between the bearing B1 and G is also given in figure, 100 mm. The distance between gear and the B2 or bearing position 2, that is 150 mm, and bearing P2 to up to the pulley, which is the hanging pulley, 150 mm. Again here in problem statement here, the transmission shaft rotating at 720, that means N is given. Then again here the P1, P2, PT, PR is also given, weight of the pulley is also given, load factor. Why to consider the load factor? In earlier session we have already discussed, because we are carrying out the static analysis, but in actual practice due to variation, when spur gear meshes with the other gear or pinion meshes with the gear, because of that what is going to happen, there may be possibility of to the deflection or because of elasticity. To take into account that dynamic, you know, the correction, so we have to introduce this load factor. That's why load factor is given 2.5. Again, in case of pulley and the chain drive, load factor takes the care of the vibrations because of this dynamic load. That's why we have to take into account this factor. But in problem statement, it is given, that is 2.5. Again, we have to select the single deep groove ball bearing at position B1 and B2. But at position B1, shaft diameter is 10 mm and at B2, shaft diameter 20 mm. That means in this problem statement, shaft diameters are given. In earlier session, we have discussed in how to select a bearing or a simple basic procedure of selection of bearing from manufacturer catalog. If shaft diameters are not given, that we have to calculate. First of all, we have to carry out the force analysis. Based on that, we have to find out the shaft diameter. And already you studied how to design a shaft in earlier course also. Now here, what we have to do? We have to select a deep groove ball bearing at position B1 and B2 for the expected life of the bearing, which is given 8,000 hours. Try to understand. Based on the given, you know, the problem statement, first of all, in first step, what we have to do? We have to write the given data. The N is equal to 720 RPM, then D1, 10 mm. D1 means at this position. At B1 side here, shaft diameter is 10 mm. D2 means the position where bearing B2, which is mounted or located, you can say, is 20 mm. Then L10H, 8,000 hours. It is in hours that we have to convert into million revolution. Then load factor 2.5. I have written all the, you know, the parameters given in problem statement. And now here, bearing B1, B2, animated video is also given here. Okay. Then again here, you know, very well in as in mentioned in problem statement, this is the radial load acting on the gear. PT is the tangential force, which is the required force to transmit the power by using a gear. Then again here, the pulley which transmits the power horizontally, and the tight side tension P1 and P2 is also shown here. Based on this, what we have to do? In as discussed earlier session, first of all, we have to calculate the radial and axial forces acting on the bearing. That is our target, to select the bearing from manufacturer's catalog. And second one is to determine the shaft diameter. But in this case, shaft diameters at bearing position B1 and B2 are given 10 mm and 20. That means no need to calculate the shaft diameter. If it's not given, that time you have to calculate it or determine the diameter of the shaft at position B1 and B2, try to understand. Then that means what we have to do here in step number one, we have to calculate only radial and axial forces acting on the bearing. For that purpose, we have to carry out the force analysis, or we have to carry out the force analysis. And for that purpose, what we have to do, we have to consider the forces in vertical plane, and we have to consider the forces in the horizontal plane. To refer this figure, you will find here, referring to this diagram, PR, which is in vertical plane, then whatever the weight of the pulley, which is acting downward direction, it is also in vertical. That means PR and weight of the pulley, that we are going to consider in vertical forces. Then PT and P1 and P2, tight side and slack side tension, it transmits, or both transmits power horizontally. So we have to consider P1 plus P2 and PT in horizontal plane to carry out force analysis. Now let us do the calculation or find out the forces. So now let us consider the forces in vertical plane. If we are going to refer this figure, you will find the RV1 is the for bearing B1, the reaction in vertical plane, and RH1 is in horizontal. Similarly, at B2, RH2 in horizontal plane, RV2 in vertical plane. At gear G, PT in horizontal and PR in vertical plane. And for the pulley, W, weight of the pulley, vertically downward direction, and P1 plus P2 in horizontal plane. And their distances are given in figure. The forces, now let us consider forces in the vertical plane. Now, the, what we have to do? The forces in vertical plane, you will get here RV1. Plus RV2, look at this figure, plus PR plus W, which is acting downward direction. How to find out the RV1 and RV2? For that purpose, you can take the moment at B1 or B2. Now, taking the moment at B1, what you will get here? So you will get PR into 100. Look at this, this PR into 100 plus this W into this distance, total how much? 400. Minus this RV2 into this distance, that is 250, is equal to 0. So by using, taking the moments at B1, you will get RV2. The RV2 is equal to 232.4 Newton. Then substitute RV2 here, we know PR, you know W, so we will get the RV1. Substituting the value of RV2, 232.4, then PR 181 and W 100, you will get RV1. Therefore, RV1 is equal to 48.6 Newton. This is for process in vertical plane. Now let us consider the process in horizontal plane. To consider the process in horizontal plane here, the taking moments at the point B1, the PT, where is the PT into this 100 plus P1 plus P2 into this 400 minus RH to here into 250, you will get RH2, and then the summation of forces in horizontal plane, you will get RH2 minus this, or you can see is equal to RH1 plus this PT plus PT plus, or you can consider the direction of the forces PT, P1 plus this and RH1 and RH2 this. So you will get RH1 100.2 Newton. In this way, we are going to calculate the reaction at bearing 1 in vertical, reaction at bearing at 2 in the vertical as well as the horizontal plane. Once you know the reactions, then what we have to do? We have to find out the reactions in bearing B1 and B2 by taking this resultant. The R1 is equal to under root RV1 square plus RH1 square. So you can substitute this value, you will get R1 is equal to 111.36 Newton, and then R2 at bearing B2, RV2 bracket square plus RH2 bracket square. You can substitute the value of RV2 and RH2, you will get 1282.43 Newton. Once you know the RV, R1 and R2, so you will get these, the bearing reaction, these are in radial direction. That means you can say R1 is equal to FRN and R2 is equal to FR2. But in this case, there is no axial force. As you know, the spur gear, there is only radial and tangential component, no axial force on the bearing. Therefore, FA1 is equal to FA2 is equal to 0. That means axial force at bearing position 1 and axial force at bearing 2 is equal to 0. That means only radial reactions or radial forces are there. That's why R1 is equal to FRN and R2 is equal to FR2. Therefore, what we have to do? We have FR1, FR2, and there is no axial force. That means FA1 0, FA2 0. Again here, shaft diameters at bearing position B1 and B2 are given in problem statement, that is 10 and 20. That's why no need to find out the shaft diameter. But we know the shaft diameter. Based on that, we can select the type of bearing for the given application. Again, how to take the bearing? Because here, based on the shaft diameter in manufacturer's catalog, for different diameters, different bearings are available. And in the bearing designation, you know very well, extra light, light, medium, and heavy duty series, different bearings are available for the same diameter. Now, referring to that manufacturer's catalog, the available bearing for 10 mm and 20 mm shaft diameters are, for 10 mm, look at this, the bearing number 61800, bearing number 6000 or 6200 and 6300 are available for 10 mm. But out of these four bearing, which one is the best suitable for particular application, that we have to decide by determining the dynamic load capacity. Similarly, for 20 mm diameter, these bearings are available in the catalog. And there the dynamic load capacity C is also given in bracket. But to select a proper bearing, we have to determine our, you know, the dynamic load capacity of the bearing for this particular application. So here in step number 2, what we have to do, these bearings are available out of that, and always select a bearing from extra light to light, medium, then we have to proceed towards the heavy duty. Otherwise, what would happen, the cost of the bearing is going to increase if we are going to select bearing directly from the catalog. Now again, the next important step to find out the or determine the values of radial and thrust factors. But you know very well, to determine the dynamic load or equivalent dynamic load, P is equal to XVFR plus YFA. But in this case, FA is equal to 0. That means whatever may be the Y value, the this magnitude of YFA becomes 0. That means P is equal to XVFR. But in this case, FA is equal to 0, so no need to go for this table, but always you have to check in step number 3, if you have to determine radial and thrust component, if there is axial load, you have to take the value of Y also, and how to select. In earlier session, I have already described this, discussed these things. When for that purpose, two ratios are required, that is FA by CO, that is static load capacity, FA is axial load, And by using FA by FR and FA by CO, you can check it whether FA by FR is less than E or greater than E. Or sometimes you have to use the interpolation to take the value of X, because the for this, when FA by FR is greater than E, the value of X is constant, that is 0.56, but Y is going to vary. And how to take the value of Y? So you have to take it from the chart, or if it lies in between them, then you have to go for interpolation. Try to understand. But when FA by FR is less than E, that time X is equal to 1, Y is equal to 0. Try to understand. So you can do this and X becomes the 1. That's why P is equal to X means 1 into V. Again, in this case, V is the rest rotation factor. When inner rest rotates, its value is 1. And when outer rest rotates, its value is 1.2 into FR. Try to understand. So simply, we can write here in this problem, no need to find out the value of Y or a thrust factor. That's fine. Directly, we will proceed to find out the equivalent dynamic load. So now we know we know the expression for equivalent dynamic load, that is P is equal to XVFR plus YFA. But FA is equal to 0, that means this term becomes 0. What is remaining? P is equal to XVFR. Again, here we are going to assume inner rest rotates, that's why V is equal to again 1. So what is remaining with you? P is equal to XFR. Again, X is equal to 1. If you are going to refer this table, FA by FR is less than 1, you will find the value of X is equal to 1. So directly you can say P is equal to FR. And by using this P is equal to FR, we are going to find out the equivalent dynamic load. Now let us find out. How to find out? Therefore, I am going to write P1 is equal to FR1. Already we have calculated 111.36 Newton. P2 is equal to FR2 is equal to 1282.43 Newton. Again, here we know the now P1, that is from FRN. Then we know the P2 from FR2. So what we have to do? We have to find out dynamic load capacity at bearing 1 for P1, or you can say for bearing 2, or for B2 for equivalent dynamic load P2. Before that, we have to convert that the life which is given in this problem statement in hours, that we have to convert it into million revolution. And how to convert it into million revolution? That is L10 is equal to 60 into N into L10H upon 10 raised to 6. L10H means in hours that you have to substitute. N is the rotation, which is also given 720 RPM. So you will get L10 in million revolution. And why we are considering the L10 life? That means 90% of the bearing can sustain that load without failure. That means only 10% of the bearings from that group are going to fail. That is L10 life. The L10 life in million revolution that we have to determine. And you will get this value, that is 345.6 million revolution. Then use load life relationship. We know very well to find out the dynamic load capacity. So we know very well the load life relationship. The C is equal to P in bracket L10 raised to 1 by 3. The 1 by 3 that we are going to use for a ball bearing, otherwise for a roller bearing, you know very well that time we have to go for the ratio of 10 by 3. In earlier session we have already discussed, but in this case we are going to select a ball bearing, that's why it's a 1 by 3. Now here P, you know very well, for a bearing 1 you can say the P1, C1 means dynamic load capacity at position B1 and L10, which is common for both. So by using this equation, we can easily find out the dynamic load capacity. Now let us find out it. For that purpose, we know the L10 life in million revolution. You know the P1, that is at bearing B1, then P2 at bearing position B2. The C1 is equal to P into L10 into 1 by 3 into load factor. And again, I have already told you why to consider the load factor in this problem statement. 2.5 is given to take into account the dynamic conditions. So therefore, C1 is equal to 111.36, that is P1 into L10, that we have to already calculated in million revolution raised to 1 by 3 into 2.5. You will get this 1953.71 Newton. Similarly, calculate C2, that is dynamic load capacity at bearing B2 position, that is P2 into L10 raised to 1 by 3 into load factor. So again here P2, 1282.43 into L10, that is 340 5.6 million revolution raised to 1 by 3 into 2.5, you will get 22,499. Now here what we have to do and how to select the bearing for in the manufacturer's catalog, for 10 mm 4 bearings are available, for 20 mm the 6 bearings are available, but which one is the best table? As our discuss earlier, we have to proceed from the extra light to up to towards heavy duty. Now let us see C1 dynamic load calculated at bearing position 1 is 1953. If I am going to select this 1953, which is greater than C1480, that means here, and the next bearing is from extra light to light, that is 6000 number bearing, which is available, is having a dynamic load capacity 4620, and our calculated is 1953. That means bearing number 6000 is suitable at position B1. Similarly, for bearing position B2 is having shaft diameter 20 mm, the calculated values here 22,499. If I am going to refer all the bearings, you will find here bearing number 6 is having the dynamic load capacity 30,000, but bearing number 56304 is having capacity 15,900, but our calculated 22. That means bearing number 66404 is suitable at position B2 having 20 mm diameter. In this way, we have to select the bearing. That means bearing number 6000, bearing number 6400, which is suitable at position B1 and at position B2 respectively. In this way, we have to select the bearing for particular applications by using manufacturer's catalog. Thank you. I have referred V. Bhandari's book, Design of Machine Element, 3rd edition, McGraw-Hill publication. Thank you. If you have any query, you can contact me through this WhatsApp number 9890426679 or mail me at pbkushare@kkwag.edu.in. Thank you. Thank you very much.